So this is the 5th annual Blue Line Arts Plates and Totem Show. It started out a show where I was trying to make clay more accessible to the collector. I wanted pieces that hung on the wall like a painting, and so I picked plates. And then I also wanted pieces that you could go in your yard or your living room, so I picked totem poles. The show has been very successful over the last 5 years, and we've had a lot of different artists, everything from mixed media to wood to clay, glass, everything you can think of, found objects. It's just been an absolutely amazing show. We've had an overwhelming reaction. We've actually already sold pieces.
Why and when? Well, there is no when. It just starts, you know, when you're a small child, and it builds, and you get more and more confident, and you continue, and then here you are on the road to art. So, and why? It's just part of my nature. It has become myself. So to me, art is a mystery, and that's how I engage in life.
Ceramics is hands-on. You can feel it. Whereas painting is very linear. It's almost like you have a Photoshop in your mind, and you think of layers. And it's like time-lapse photography. You have an idea, and then you put it down bit by bit. With clay, you can be more involved. You can basically work with it, you can feel it. It's completely different. I love it. It's a totally different medium, and I think I can find a way of expressing myself a lot more.
Well, there is a big difference between the ceramics and painting, although I like to try to preserve all the energy of being a painter, because it's very subjective and personal for me. And that energy is what I try to give into the ceramics. So it's very physical. It isn't like a putter, you know, it's a Zen kind of thing. For me, it's more explosive. So I can enter into the clay and pull it apart, or thump it, or push it, exert a kind of a life force into ceramic.
I'm from China, Dalian. It's north of China. It's a very like beautiful city. When I started to make my art, I was like 8 years old. I just know this is my destiny to make art. So why I'm come to America is a really good question, because I moved to America with my husband. But at the beginning, I really lost. I don't know like what kind of art I make. So I just emailed to Blue Line Arts, Tony. So I mean, this exhibition is really amazing. I appreciate everything he done for me. So I make my plate. It's based on recycling life.
Well, I've been a working artist for probably over 30 years. I began, I guess like most of us did when I was a little kid. And I find that making art, both visual and literary, is a way that I explore the world and things that are going on in it.
I started making art because I was required to take an art class at UC Davis as a math major in 1962. It was a class taught by a wonderful man, great artist, William T. Wiley. And rather than the normal class, where the professor would drag out these little computer cards with the little sticks, you know, punch holes in them, and read off your name, and you were supposed to reply, present. He put them in his motorcycle helmet, threw his gloves on top of it, and went through the studio and gathered this phenomenal still life. You know, skulls, skeletons, vases, dried flowers, and said, draw that. And those of us who were not required to take this course subtly kind of dwindled away. But I was so intrigued. I was just drawing like crazy. And he came and commented on it. And it came to be that I spent a lot of time, you know, talking with him, and he would bring books on Albert Pinkham Ryder and James Ensor and Antonio Gaudi and all this material that I was digesting so fast led me to become tardy to my calculus of variations. And the Pakistani professor that was teaching it said, "Miss Gagaris, if you're late one more time, you will flunk." Shudder. No, I didn't want to flunk. So I changed my major. And I took every art course at UC Davis I could possibly take. I just was kind of allowed to do my thing. If I wanted to make a ceramic, Wiley would say, "Well, ask Bob Arneson if you can use TB9 and we'll fire it for you." And the only hint I got on making clay pieces is don't use too much water.
Well, Tony Natsula's got me started in making ceramics of everything in the world, and the plate was ongoing. There was plate after plate after plate. And the imagery is just something that comes out of me when I work in anything. I don't plan it, I just do it. And I love that ability. With clay, you can make something so immediate and then make another thing and then stick it onto something else, and it's wonderful.
The sculpture I made for this show is called Americana. It is a satirical view, in my mind, of certain things that I have learnt to live with, or I'm trying to live with, now that I live in America. Coming from Britain, you tend to be quite satirical about most things. And so I'm trying to shake it off, but I'm doing it in a kind of a humorous way. And so the piece really is a very kind of silly and naive view of some of the conspiracy theories regarding America. You know, you have the sea turtles at the bottom, which is more of a Polynesian view of how the universe was formed. And then at the top, you've got the Statue of Liberty, but actually it's a spaceship, you know, with a couple of aliens coming out. You know, and that might offend some, but in my way, it's a way of observing the funny side of life and the funny side of living in America. And the ceramic piece itself lends itself so well. I mean, as you were saying, clay lends itself so well to communicating these things. If I painted it, it would have been flat. But this way you can walk around it. I can put lots of things in it from, you know, the Judeo-Christian roots, you know, and then the Egyptian pyramid. The whole thing is in there. It's like a crazy comic, you know. And I think it worked very well. I think I have some inspiration for doing more pieces.
Clay is one that requires more time between the immediate result than painting. Painting is instantaneous. You can change it, you know, very shortly, especially if you stick it out in the sunlight and let it dry fast. But clay, you have to be your own audience, which is like getting a gift when you take open the kiln, or weeping a lot when they're all broken up. So anyway, that's the difference for me. The images and stuff I do sort out, and I pre-think through some elements, and of course mountains being part of the landscape. This is a landscape. And oh yes, circular forms are called tondos, aren't they? I learned that in art history class some time ago, but I thought I brought it off, and that's about all I can say about any piece I make.
I create unlimited thoughts based on combination and with Taoist philosophy and Western culture, contemporary culture. I choose three separate layers because there is a Tao belief says that if you have one, you will have two. If you have two, you will have three. If you have three, you will have all the universe. So you can see a lot of different elements in my art, such as leaves and waves, ocean, and birds and fish and babies. No matter new life or death, life always going on. Just like my work stands represent a recycling life. So I use acrylic drawing on the plastic paper, then I cut it like a different shape and paste on the new layers.
So the piece I have in this show is the Feast of Guanaluja. And Guanaluja is a myth that I have been creating on my own, exploring it through a variety of materials, collage and paint, and now in textile. The piece here, the Feast of Guanaluja, is actually a free motion machine embroidery piece. So the entire piece was created, woven, if you will, on my sewing machine, a very old sewing machine that I've had since 1976. And it involves a number of fibers, cottons and silks and polyesters, and it's just a matter of just looking, and it's painting with threads, but in a different way.
There is a very long tradition of art support, if you like, in Britain. Perhaps not so much these days, whereas I think in America you tend to be on your own, which in some ways is good, because you really have to find your feet. But on the other hand, sometimes I feel that there is a lack of a certain something within my own life, if you like. But I'm working towards, you know, trying to adapt, you know, to the many different cultures and many different things.
Inspiration? I'm doing a series of Maya's Majestic Mountains, and they are the mountains that I've seen, and some of which I have taken the train up to the top, and they include things like, you know, peaceful Pikes Peak and majestic McKinley, and this one is Super Shasta. And the reason I did this one was to put it in the show.
My advice for a person beginning in clay is to remember that your voice is the most important, and you have a voice that's different than everybody else's. So your life has all that information which you give into your art, and that life that you've been leading is your vocabulary.
So the myth of Guanaluja began probably a couple of years ago, and it's grown out of a collage piece that incorporated a creature that is part bird and part fish, and some people call it a fish and some people call it a bird. And I think if you trace its actual origins, it goes back farther than that to a poem that I wrote several years ago. And Guanaluja it doesn't come from any particular culture. It's a contemporary myth, and it's a creature that is just kind of changing and exploring the world in many different ways, I guess. There is no specific story about Guanaluja at this point. It's still in the evolving stages. So fiber is a medium that I used to work in primarily. It was my first medium that I really found that I loved. I love the texture of working with textiles, and I'm not a quilter. I love the quilts and I love the art quilts, but I don't work in that. I am a costumer and I sew and design clothing. And I have a love for hand embroidery. And several years ago, I took the hand embroidery and kind of moved it over to machine embroidery and to see what I could do. And I the technique that I use incorporates some netting as well as the threads, and the particular type of stabilizer that I use. So in order to run it through the machine, you have to have some sort of a stabilizer. So that stabilizer then acts as the thing that can allow me to mold and shape the piece and yet have it be extremely light. How that differs from how that differs from painting or other medium that I've worked in before. I do a lot of work with painting, acrylics and watercolor, also pen and ink is another medium that I explore as well. Ceramics and clay I really love, and I just don't seem to have a knack for it, so.
I have a lot like exhibition experiences in China when I was a student. During this time, I traveled to Oslo, Italy, and different countries like Thailand or Korea to have my exhibitions. So as like exchange international student to show their like exchange culture stuff.
I come from, as I said, from a culture which tends to examine and view everything in minute detail, and of course no one is safe, but there's also a lot of culture and a lot of cynicism and a lot of satire, and I happen to like the satire part, so I'm willing to put my neck out on the line, you know, even though sometimes I get very strange views when I say something here. You know, people stare at me because they really don't know that I'm being satirical, or perhaps they think I'm being serious. That's fun. Sometimes it's not, of course. So I was actually born in the former Yugoslavia, but I moved to Britain when I was very young. And from an early age, obviously, I really liked art. I enjoyed sciences, but in the end, I had a fabulous teacher who actually made it possible for me to go to a British art school. And I thoroughly enjoyed myself, although I was left alone for nearly 5 years to make up my mind about, you know, what really art is. I had a great time, and I survived the 60s. However, when I left art school, that was a different scene altogether. My first job, my boss said, "I want you to forget everything. I want you to do this and this and this." So I struggled for a few years to capture what I'd you know, essentially learned at art school. But then eventually, by about 1976, I decided to go pro, and I just took the leap, and I've been doing it ever since. Painting was obviously my passion, but now that I have a great teacher, I will enjoy, you know, the 3D a lot more. I mean, I have done 3D, but, you know, this is a new start for me.